Good evening, everybody, Your Excellency, dear professors and students. Since the order of the TR chair tonight is a canon lawyer, I have asked a canon lawyer to introduce our guest, Father Loïc-Marie Lebotte, the Dean of the Faculty of Canon Law and Vice Rector of the Pontifical University, St. Thomas Aquinas.
Eccellenza, carissimi professori, cari studenti, gentili ospiti qui presenti e coloro che ci raggiungono tramite lo streaming, come si dice in buon italiano, sono molto lieto di darvi il benvenuto nella nostra Pontificia Università in occasione della settima conferenza della Cattedra TR organizzata dall'Istituto di Studi Ecumenici dell'Angelicum in collaborazione con il Pontificio Consiglio per la promozione dell'unità dei cristiani. Ringrazio anche molto il padre Yacen d'Estivel di lasciarmi l'occasione di dare il benvenuto alla nostra collega di diritto canonico Miriam Weylands, che insegna il diritto canonico e ordinaria di diritto canonico presso la Facoltà di Teologia Cattolica dell'Università di Erfurt in Germania. Come noto, quest'anno si parla molto della sinodalità e anche la professoressa è molto indicata per parlare di questo tema perché è consulente del Sinodo dei Vescovi. Anche non è l'unica cosa che si trova nel suo curriculum vitae che è molto impressionante, sia a livello accademico che per l'impegno nella vita della Chiesa, sia nel livello di diritto canonico, dell'ecclesiologia, della vita religiosa, della protezione dei minori, temi come sappiamo molto importanti oggi, e dell'ecumenismo, perché siamo qui per parlare anche nella cattedra TR dell'ecumenismo. E come è noto, in vista del sinodo sulla sinodalità, la cattedra TR quest'anno ha un tema su camminare insieme, sinodalità e unità dei cristiani. E dunque per questo la professoressa Miriam Weylands è molto indicata per parlare di questo. Io voglio segnalare anche che oltre il compito di consultore presso il Sinodo, assume molti incarichi presso la Santa Sede, notevolmente della Pontificia Commissione per la Tutela dei Minori, per la membra della Commissione anche Fede e Costituzione, se non è questo direttamente legato alla Santa Sede, è esperto in questioni canoniche presso l'Unione Internazionale dei Superiori Maggiori. Come decano della Facoltà di Diritto Canonico sono particolarmente interessato ad ascoltare questa conferenza intitolata La Chiesa di Dio, convocata in Sinodo, sfide e teologiche canoniche circa il Sinodo del 2021-2023. Ringraziamo della sua accettazione, della sua venuta qua e l'ascoltiamo con interesse. Grazie.
Excellency, professors, students, and guests. Thank you, Father Yacen d'Estivel, for the invitation to give the TR lecture, and thank you, Father Loïc-Marie Lebotte, for your kind words of welcome. It is a great honor. It is a great honor for me to give this TR lecture, because it brings back lovely memories of my study time in Ottawa, where I had the privilege of meeting Father Jean-Marie Tillard in the 1980s. I was fascinated by his work and asked if we could meet. It was a memorable event in the Collège Dominicain in Ottawa. The church, and in particular the ecumenical world, owes Father Tillard a lot. Tillard was maybe not personally involved in the drafting of documents of Vatican II, but he acted as an advisor for the Canadian bishops at the council. He became a key player in the reception of the Second Vatican Council. a document like the 1995 encyclical Ut Unum Sint could not have been published without the thoughts he and others developed. That visit to Father Tiar in Ottawa brings to me another Dominican who lived and worked not only there, but also here at the Angelicum, Father Albert Gauthier, a professor of the history of canon law and of Roman law. He was among my first professors in Ottawa. He, a French-speaking Canadian, explained Roman law in his best English. And my English was very poor. My notes, I only have them in phonetic writing. After 4 weeks, I had to explain in the oral exam what usucapio means. I will never forget his generosity and learned from him to be a teacher who looks for the best in students. My visits to him here at the Angelicum in the 1990s were a delight. The untimely death of these two Dominicans was and is a great loss for the church and for the academic world. Just imagine what they could have contributed to the topic we address today, synodality. The one from a theological and ecumenical perspective, the other from understanding how the church receives models from Roman law and its institutions to discern and decide. Together, they could have helped us to understand what was divine inspiration and how, from early times onwards, the church took recourse to models available from the secular world to bring the insights to be a fruit. That in itself would give us space to breathe, as we are invited to do the same today. So it is a great honor for me to give this lecture here today at the Angelicum. What the Lord is asking of us is already in some sense present in the word synod. Journeying together, laity, pastors, the Bishop of Rome is an easy concept to put into words, but not so easy to put into practice. With these words, Pope Francis commemorated the 50th anniversary of the Synod of Bishops in October 2015. On March 7, 2020, it was announced that the next Synod of Bishops would be on synodality and would be entitled For a Synodal Church Communion Participation Mission. On September 7 this year, the preparatory document for the Synod was published. It opens with the words, "The Church of God is convoked in Synod." On October 10, Pope Francis solemnly inaugurated the Synod for the entire Church, and a week later, the synodal process began in the local churches when bishops in their own dioceses around the world celebrated with their people its opening. The preparatory document writes in the opening paragraph, "One fundamental stage will be the celebration of the 16th Ordinary General Assembly of the Synod of Bishops in October 2023, which will be followed by the implementation phase that will again involve the particular churches." Now, before continuing, it is possible to notice that these developments reveal already three unique points that warrant a rather theological reflection. First, the documents speak about a synod in which the whole church is engaged, not just bishops. Secondly, the process reveals a unique implementation of the doctrine that the church exists in and from the local churches. It's not a one-way direction. And thirdly, the process envisions an implementation phase of the synod. I will have to return to these points. So let's go back. Returning to the current process, one can see that what lies ahead is rather unique. The task of the synod is at the same time the resource. The object is at the same time the method. All are invited to experience and not just to understand, to experience synodality so that a conversion from a hierarchical to a synodal church can occur. A conversion that will lead to a change in the way the people of God, which includes bishops and priests, interact with each other. Hence, the church gathered in synod may reap some of the fruits of a synodal conversion as all engage in experiencing it, reflecting upon it, and sharing what they have learned. The intention is that this will enlighten all in grasping what it means to be more synodal. The hope is that the synod will assist each and every baptized person, which again includes the bishops and the other clergy, to discover more deeply the meaning of baptism. As Pope Francis put it during a day of reflection before the opening of the synod, and I quote, "In the church, everything starts with baptism. Baptism, the source of our life, gives rise to the equal dignity of the children of God, albeit in the diversity of ministries and charisms. Consequently, all the baptized are called to take part in the church's life and mission. Enabling everyone to participate is an essential ecclesial duty. All the baptized, for baptism is our identity card." End of quote. Indeed, baptism calls each person to experience and live communion, participate more fully in the life of the church, and engage more deeply in the missionary task that each baptized person as an individual enjoys and that the community as such has. To be a more synodal church is a prerequisite for discerning the working of the Holy Spirit for and in our time. As Pope Francis puts it, it is precisely this part of synodality which God expects of the church in the third millennium. So as the church walks the journey, it takes another step in the reception of the Second Vatican Council. This step gives in particular shape to the doctrines that find expression in the dogmatic constitution on the church, Lumen Gentium, chapter 2, entitled The People of God, and in the dogmatic constitution on Revelation, Dei Verbum. Key words in this area are baptism, People of God, Sensus Fidelium, and Holy Spirit. My presentation will attend to some of these aspects. The Synod for the entire church, which begins in the local churches, whether they belong to the Latin Church or to one of the 23 churches, Eastern churches sui juris, provides an occasion to discern together and offer valuable elements with regard to the strengths and achievements, as well as the limitations and challenges of being a synodal church. Hence, the first step consists of the local churches as communities of faithful, journeying together under the guidance of their diocesan bishops by listening and sharing their experiences of what it means to be a synodal church. Theologically, one can say that there is a hope that the at times too exclusive Christological foundation of exercising leadership in the church will be complemented, not replaced, but complemented by an increased pneumatological one. The main question for the first stage of the synod in this process is, how do we encounter the Holy Spirit guiding the church as it journeys to fulfill its unique mission to proclaim the good news as we live here and now? Indeed, the purpose of the synodal process is ultimately not a mere inward looking, but the consultation occurs in view of being more deeply the Church of Christ, so as to live communion, achieve participation in order to proclaim with integrity and effectively the gospel, that is, to be a truly missionary church. Such a task cannot be envisioned without an ecumenical dimension. The commitment of the Second Vatican Council to the restoration of Christian unity, which St. Paul, John Paul II qualified as irrevocable, implies that all reflections, processes, and actions must occur while keeping in mind the implications for bringing about the unity of the Church of Christ. Ecumenism does not come as an add-on, but needs to be part of what we think and do. Synod and synodality, the two terms might cause some confusion. Whereas synod presupposes synodality, synodality itself is not limited to holding synods. Synods are one form or expression among many others to practice synodality. Being a synodal church finds also expression to consultation and participation in discerning processes as they occur, for example, in presbyteral councils, as well as in diocesan and parish councils, in diocesan synods, as well as in plenary and particular councils. And in a place like this, we have, like the Anglican the Angelicum with the Dominican tradition, we have the chapters in religious institutes. However, being an acting synodal goes beyond formal structures. It is encountering, listening, discerning, deciding. Indeed, it is engaging together in encountering God and the other by listening to the word of God and sharing the experience that together when all reflect and grasp the experience in light of reading the signs of the times. It means discerning what the Holy Spirit asks from the community here and now. Finally, the competent authority takes a decision. Synodality in its deepest sense is therefore not about structures, but refers to an internal disposition of how Christians together interact with each other while arriving at a decision. Structures and institutions are to facilitate these processes. If they are to facilitate, it means that a regular evaluation of them might be in place. For example, are they providing optimal results in light of available resources in this place at this time in history? Adaptations might be necessary. There are those different articulations of synodality. First, there is the style. This is the modus vivendi and operandi with which the people of God live and work. It touches on an internal disposition. Second, there are the structures and processes governed by theology and canon law, which are to facilitate listening and discerning. As a canon lawyer, it is necessary to articulate a caution, no matter how well these institutions are governed by law, even if they are obligatory. If there is no internal disposition to bring synodality to life through them, it simply will not work. Such would be the case when a bishop, for example, merely informs the presbyteral council what he has already decided on, instead of truly engaging in listening and discerning with the council before deciding. In the third aspect, there are the specific synodal events convoked by the competent authority involving all to discern the way forward. The Secretariat of the Synod of Bishops published the preparatory document on September 7, 2021. The document recalls that the journeying together can be understood from two perspectives that are interconnected. The first concerns the internal life of the churches. It's between all faithful laity, clergy, religious, and the pastors. It also has an ecumenical dimension because we share in the gift of baptism. So I think it's good to notice that the ecumenical dimension belongs to the internal life of the church. The second considers journeying together with the whole human family. It focuses on relations with people of other religions, with people who are distant from the faith, and with people of specific social environments and groups, the world of culture, economics, finance, as well as the poor and the excluded. Now, before attending to some of the theological and canonical issues, it is possible to present a bit of the flavor and atmosphere of the process that is commencing at the moment. In order to facilitate the listening and consultative process, the preparatory document presents 10 thematic nuclei that articulate different aspects of synodality. They present topics that can be addressed by the people of God in the local churches. However, the document explicitly mentions that the way they are addressed needs to be adapted to the local circumstances. With such a consideration, the preparatory document implements Vatican's II attention for the necessity to attend to the local context and enculturation, allowing for the church to be truly Catholic. So it's not the same everywhere. We have to see what are the possibilities, but also what are the needs in the different churches. And actually, one beautiful example is a diocese that has rewritten already the documents for children in the language of children. So that is, they are protagonists in our church. They are not just receivers. So the questions focus on, and I will just mention the 10 points, journeying companions. Who are we as a church? Who is the we, and who is not included in this? How do we listen and with what kind of attitude and prejudices, for example, with regard to youth, women and minorities? Second, listening, to whom do we listen? How do we identify prejudices and stereotypes that hinder a true listening? A third point is speaking out. All are invited to speak, but what kind of style of communication do we have? Do we allow all to speak up freely and with courage? Fourth aspect is celebrating. Journeying together is only possible when it is based on communal listening to the word and celebrating the Eucharist. How do prayer and liturgical celebrations inspire and direct the journey and decision making? A fifth point, co-responsibility in the mission. All are responsible for the mission of the church. So how is each best person called to be a protagonist in this? How are people supported by the community when they engage in science, in politics, care for creation? The sixth point is dialogue in church and society. What modes of dialogue do we have? How do we handle divisions and divergences? How do we dialogue with neighboring dioceses, ecclesial movements and religious institutes, with other religions and non-believers? A seventh, with the other Christian denominations. Who are the other Christians with whom we live in the same territory, and what relation do we have with them? What fruits and difficulties came to the fore in journeying together? An 8 point, authority and participation. A synodal church is participatory and co-responsible. How does the community identify the goals to be pursued, the way to achieve them, and the steps to be taken forward? And how is authority exercised? What about teamwork? How does co-responsibility unfold? The 9 point is discerning and deciding. What procedures and methods are used to make decisions while listening to the Holy Spirit? How is participation in decision-making within hierarchically structured communities promoted? And how does the consultative phase and the deliberative phase relate to each other? And finally, there is the question of formation in synodality. It's almost a prerequisite for the above. What formation of people to live the practice of journeying together, of listening, of discerning, is really available? In other words, what formation of discernment and exercising authority is offered? The first phase of the synod is a consultation in the local churches, in which experience, listening, and discerning of all faithful under the guidance of the Holy Spirit are central in view of the mission of the church. To assist the churches in this process, a handbook has been developed, Father Megan. Now, Sister Natalie talked about that handbook a few weeks ago. Theological reflections. The synodal process does warrant some theological reflections that have canonical implications and present some challenges. What follows are only some points. In duplicity, others can be mentioned. So the first one is the Synod of the entire Church and the Synod of Bishops. The Church of God is convoked in Synod, the opening line of the document on the Synod. These are the first words. Pope Francis opened the Synod on October 10, 2021. The question arises, is this the Synod of Bishops convoked for 2023? No. As the Father Makem states, the synodal process is no longer only an assembly of bishops, but a journey for all faithful in which every local church has an integral part to play. The Second Vatican Council reinvigorated the sense that all the baptized, including the hierarchy and the laity, are called to be active participants in the saving mission of the church, point 1.3 in the Vatican Magnum. The new form of synod also finds expression in its logo, which reads 2021-2023, as you can see. And there was a conversation about this. Should it be 23 or 21-23? The new understanding of the Synod expresses some fundamental changes brought about by Vatican II. In order to understand and appreciate these changes, it is necessary to return to the Council, in particular to the two major documents, Lumen Gentium on the Church and Dei Verbum on Revelation. The ecclesiological changes in Vatican II cannot be fully appreciated without attending to Vatican I. The latter council had attended to the papacy in particular. Due to the war in Europe, the council had to be closed before it had been possible to attend to the relationship between the Pope and the bishops, as well as between the Pope and the College of Bishops. The subject concerned both so-called papal dogmas, primacy and infallibility. Vatican II attended to these questions and did so in what ultimately was going to be chapter 3 of Lumen Gentium, entitled The Hierarchy. In the third chapter, there is a clarification that bishops are members of the College of Bishops by ordination and being in hierarchical communion. The relationship between a bishop and the local church was not developed, which causes problems later on. And we will also speak about that later today. The chapter also clarified that the Pope alone, or the College of Bishops with the Pope, but not without him, holds supreme authority in the church. It can teach infallible. Furthermore, the council teaches that the diocesan bishop is a vicar of Christ for the diocese and trusted to his care. He is not the vicar of the Pope. Central understanding is the doctrine of collegiality of bishops. The doctrine of collegiality of bishops. That's one side of the coin. Beside these doctrinal clarifications, the bishops gathered in the council, they experienced how beneficial it was for the Pope, for themselves, as well as for the church at large, to meet in person and to listen to each other, obtain firsthand information, and thus becoming aware of the richness and challenges, the diversity and unity of the church in all corners of the world. Not only did they ask that the Roman Curia be internationalized, they also felt that regular meetings of the bishops from around the world with the Pope would be beneficial. It would allow, they said, for the exchange of firsthand information on specific issues. Yet the bishops were also aware that it would be impossible for all to gather regularly. The doctrine of collegiality of bishops, together with the experience, then led to the idea that a representation of the College of Bishops could meet regularly with the Pope. Yet, not everybody in the council was so sure as to what powers this body should be given, deliberative or merely consultative. Some were indeed afraid that such a body might diminish the powers of the Pope. Possibly in order to prevent further discussions, Pope Paul VI decided to create a new institution which he called the Synod of Bishops, and did so just before the opening of the fourth session of the council. The composition of this body was such that indeed membership of the college was membership of the College of Bishops seems to be the requirement. The episcopal conferences were invited to elect some bishops from their territory, and the number depends on the size of the episcopal conference. The conference is thus used as a vehicle to secure a certain form of representation of the College of Bishops. Those elected do not have to be diocesan bishops. They can be titular bishops. They can even be retired bishops. Indeed, the bishops gathered in synod do not primarily participate as diocesan bishops. In conclusion, one can see that the Synod of Bishops thus came about to give expression to the doctrine on the relationship between the Pope and the bishops as members of the College of Bishops. It was not conceived as an institution that would give expression to the doctrine on the relationship between the local churches and the entire church, nor to the doctrine on the people of God. However, Vatican II made another decision. The Council Fathers very consciously decided that in the draft of Lumen Gentium, in which there was a chapter on the hierarchy, followed by the laity and one on the religious, a new chapter should be inserted in which that would find expression what all have in common. The chapter was going to be chapter 2 of Lumen Gentium, entitled The People of God. It was inserted before the chapters on the hierarchy, laity, and religious. Chapter 2 includes indeed what all baptized hold in common. and expresses what all faithful together make up the people of God due to being baptized in Christ. All share in the threefold ministry of Christ. Hence, this chapter also presents a reflection about the relation to the other Christians and the non-baptized. The chapter expresses the doctrine on the infallibility of the church in Lumen Gentium 12, and not just of Pope or the Pope with the bishops. It affirms that the church as such and as a whole has a missionary task. Through the doctrine expressed, it is clear that the hierarchy stands in service to the people of God. Why is it necessary to mention all of this? Well, the problem with the dogmatic constitution is that the chapter on the people of God was inserted, but the consequences flowing from it were not reconsidered with regard to chapter 3 on the hierarchy. In a way, chapter 2 and chapter 3 stand side by side. Without a new synthesis being developed, they are what we call in the theological world juxtaposed. The post-conciliar church saw itself confronted with handling this juxtaposition. Considering the conscious decision of the council to insert a chapter on the people of God before the one on the hierarchy, the juxtaposition could only be resolved by an appropriate hermeneutics of Vatican II. It means interpreting chapter 3 on the hierarchy through the lenses of the doctrine expressed in chapter 2 on the people of God. A crucial point in this reception was the promulgation of the Code of Canon Law in 1983. A careful analysis reveals that the legislator oftentimes considered one aspect of the doctrine while the other is given less weight or even completely ignored. There are quite a number of these kind of juxtapositions in the Second Vatican Council. Examples of this are the fact that if a bishop would wish to govern his diocese without the involvement of any layperson, he could do so, as no entity in which laypersons do participate till today is obligatory. Another example concerns the role of the magisterium in exercising the teaching office, invoking the obligation for the faithful to obedience without, at the same time, making any provisions for ascertaining the sensus fidei fidelio. Canon law has no provisions for that. And yet, Pope John Paul II made a remarkable comment when he promulgated the 1983 Code of Canon Law, in when he said, what constitutes a substantial newness of the Second Vatican Council, in line with the legislative tradition of the Church, especially with regard to ecclesiology, constitutes likewise the newness of the new code. And then he goes on to say that this newness exists in the doctrine of the people of God and hierarchical authority as service, and the doctrine according to which all members of the people of God, in the way suited to each of them, participate in the threefold priestly, prophetic, and kingly office of Christ, to which doctrine is also linked that which concerns the duties and rights of the faithful and particularly of the laity. We find this in Sacrae Disciplinae Leges, the constitution with which he promulgated the 1983 code. Before further reflecting on the consequences and challenges of this poses, it is helpful to recall the deep theological reasons for emphasizing the relevance of what all share in common and how the people of God as such is a protagonist in the church. The deeper cause lies with Vatican's true understanding of revelation and the role of teaching authority in the church. As the Council Fathers gathered in Rome for the Second Vatican Council, they brought with them an understanding of revelation that was considered to occur in a hierarchically ordered way, from Christ to Peter and the other apostles to the Pope, and from there to the bishops, the priest, and finally to the laity, who would receive the teaching in obedience. It was a merely top-down model and very much Christomonistic in its foundation. Furthermore, revelation was very much considered to be a set of doctrines formulated in propositions that the faithful had to learn by heart. To assist them in this, catechisms were produced. The second chapter of Lumen Gentium, as well as the dogmatic constitution of Revelation, display a new understanding. Revelation is not so much a set of doctrines, but rather an encounter of persons with God. Men and women encounter God personally. God speaks to them as friends and enters into fellowship with them, the verbum number two. The word of God is listened to and heard by all, including the ordained. It all begins with listening, not to each other, but listening to the word of God, which is directed to each and everyone. Yet the word of God can only be understood under guidance of the Holy Spirit through a complex interaction of all the faithful, each and everyone, according to his or her position and function. In the listening process, the Holy Spirit leads into relationship and understanding revelation, the verbum number 5. The Church of God is thus a listening church before it is a teaching church. This understanding touches on the notion of tradition. Tradition occurs through all the faithful. Lumen Gentium 12 uses for this the term sensus fidei fidelium, the sense of the faith of all faithful, not only of all places, but also of all times. That then has an impact on the understanding of the doctrine on infallibility. The church as such is infallible, says Lumen Gentium number 12. The latter understanding has always been the case, but it had somewhat been forgotten, even up to the point that more or less on the eve of Vatican II, the infallibility of the church had been reduced to a passive infallibility, whereas the infallibility of particularly the Pope was considered to be an active infallibility. Hence, on the eve of Vatican II, there was almost a danger that the infallibility of the church had become dependent on the infallibility of what was called the magisterium. As a result of studies in particular of the church fathers, Vatican II recovered the understanding that revelation occurs within the people of God in a complex network of relations between all faithful, from laypersons to bishops. Such an understanding can only be appreciated in light of the doctrines that through baptism, all faithful participate in the threefold ministry of Christ and receive charisms, Lumen Gentium 14, as well as the doctrine that the Holy Spirit is active in each and everyone. For a proper understanding, it is relevant to realize that the Holy Spirit does not work in isolation, but that different people are dependent on each other. The individual cannot believe without the community. At the same time, the common faith lives in the lived faith of the faithful. There it finds its most comprehensive and most diverse expression. Hence, the living faith is an important witness and source of faith, and thus a locus theologicus. This implies a need for a common listening, as well as a need for mutual obedience and respect of laity and hierarchy. And all of this then finds expression in Lumen Gentium 12. I quote, the entire body of faithful cannot err in matters of faith. The believing church, the church in credendo, is infallible, and discernment in matters of faith is aroused and sustained by the spirit of truth. It is exercised not just under the guidance of the teaching authority, but there is a circularity between the sensus fidelium and the teaching authority. Whereas Lumen Gentium 12 still sees the people of God under the guidance of the sacred teaching authority in faithful and respectful obedience, Dei Verbum number 10 articulates a circularity between the people of God and pastors. It says, sacred tradition and sacred scripture form one sacred deposit of the word of God committed to the church. Holding fast to this deposit, the entire holy people united with their shepherd remains always steadfast in the teaching of the apostles, in the common life, in the breaking of the bread, and in prayers. So that holding to, practicing and professing the heritage of faith, it becomes on the part of the bishops and faithful a single common effort, end of quote. As a result, the infallibility of Pope and bishops, in more recent times referred to as magisterium, is embedded with the infallibility of the church. The infallibility in docendo falls within the infallibility in credendo. Now, what does this all have to do with the synod? As outlined above, the Synod of Bishops, which Paul VI erected in 1965, on the one hand, resulted from the experience that it is beneficial for the Pope and the bishops to discern together regularly relevant subjects, and on the other hand, had its theological foundation in the newly understood doctrine between the papacy and episcopal collegiality. The Synod of Bishops thus gave expression to the doctrine articulated in particular in chapter 3 of Lumen Gentium on the hierarchy, but not in chapter 2 on the people of God. Pope Francis, however, while seeking for a form to give expression to the insights as expressed in chapter 2 on the people of God and all it entails, concludes that there is a need for journeying together. From the beginning of his pontificate, Pope Francis has stressed the need to place the people of God at the center, and then he envisioned the hierarchy as standing in service to the people of God to fulfill its mission. Whereas in the past, synods on the family, the youth, and the Amazon, the listening occurred before the synod, the Pope has now integrated this into the synod itself. With this, the synod thus has become an expression not just of the doctrine on collegiality of bishops, but of the people of God. Within the synod, there will be an assembly of the synod of bishops. Thus, in a way, the doctrine that finds expression in chapter 3 of Lumen Gentium is integrated in this new structure. The interaction of the local church and the church universal. There is more to be seen. Vatican II affirmed that the local church is for the church, that the church is a portio populo Dei. It's a portion. It's not a part of the entire church. It is a portion entrusted to the bishop to shepherd. Hence, not the bishop has a diocese, but the diocese has a bishop. And then if we think that way, we can come to the notion of ministry. The council affirmed that the church exists in and from the local churches, in quibus et ex quibus, Lumen Gentium 23. The one cannot be thought of without the other. Another Dominican whom I respect and like very much, Hervé Le Grand, has explained this well over the years. It's like a cake. You cannot have the cake without the portions, and each portion at the same time contains the fullness of that cake. So the synod now begins in the local churches, and there will be an interaction from the local churches with the entire church. We may recall Vatican II was successful because the local churches were able to bring their fruits to the benefit of the church universal. The council would not have been successful without the work and the contribution of the local churches. The Germans contributed with a lot of insights about the liturgy. The French church contributed so much with the church fathers. The freedom of religion was a subject that came from the United States. But the American bishops brought in the subject, but I think it was with the help of the French that they could give a theological foundation for the insights that they had. In the discernment process, the council pondered about the fruits offered to the council and decided what was to be received as it was for the edification. I think that's an important term, whether something is for the edification of the entire church. This was followed by a process of reception back into the local churches. The in quibus et ex quibus is this a flowing movement. Something similar is now happening, beginning in the local churches under the leadership of the bishop. The people of God in prayer discern what the Spirit has to say of how we can be God's church in our time and in our place. This will require a careful and prayerful listening in the different stages. The bishops on behalf of the dioceses will share the results with the bishops who shepherd the other local churches in the Episcopal Conference. It's not just writing a document. The bishops are invited to sit together and to discern and say, what are the people telling us? Remarkably, the documents do not say that the report is to be a faithful report and that it is not to be what the bishop thinks the entire church or the pope wants to hear. It's already remarkable that that this is being written in the documents. It is also not the report of the diocesan bishop as a person, but of the local church. It is just the report of the communio fidelium in the local church. And the bishop then gives witness to the faith of his local church, its joys, its pain, its challenges. The bishop within an episcopal conference, all of them are subsequently invited to discern together the results coming from the local churches in what this means for the territory of their conference. In a year's time, the reports of the conferences will be the basis for Instrumentum Laboris number one, which will be the basis for further reflection in continental structures. Here too, it is remarkable that these structures will be involved, as it is a recognition of the complexity and diversity of the world. Based on the reports from several different parts of the world, so the CELAM, the Federation of Asian Bishops Conferences, the CCEE, all these different groups will then discern together and will write a further report, which then will be the basis for the Instrumentum Laboris number two presented for the Assembly of Bishops in 2023. This will be followed by an implementation phase that will again involve the local churches. Indeed, the in quibus et ex quibus will become a flowing mechanism. The whole structure strengthens the relation between the local and the entire church. It will give expression to the catholicity of the church. As Lumen Gentium 13 states, between all the parts of the church there remains a bond of close communion whereby they share spiritual riches, apostolic workers, and temporal resources. For the members of the people of God are called to share these goods in common, and of each of the churches the word of the apostle hold good. A quote, according to the gift that each has received, administer it to one another as good stewards of the manifold grace of God, end of quote. In many ways, the interactive process will give a new relevance to the diocesan bishop, as more than ever before will he be a witness to the fate of the local church entrusted to his care. It also highlights, maybe for the first time, the relationship between the communio fidelium, the communio ecclesiarum, and the communio episcoporum. And yet, something else comes to the fore. It is the role of titular bishops. These are those bishops who do not have to pastoral care for a specific local church. There are different titular bishops. Some are auxiliary bishop. They assist the diocesan bishop in the pastoral care of the diocese. Others are retired bishops, or they are bishops who, for example, working in the Roman Curia, or they work as an apostolic nuncio. All these bishops are due to their ordination a member of the College of Bishops. Hence, as long as the Synod of Bishops was a gathering of bishops belonging to the college, the meaning of the synod differed. And one can see this in the authentic interpretation that an episcopal conference may elect a retired bishop to participate in the synod. What does that tell us ecclesiologically, that an episcopal conference can elect a retired bishop? It would seem that in light of the doctrine expressed with the trias communio fidelium, ecclesiarum, and episcoporum, the role of the titular bishops in synods of bishops is in need of a careful theological reflection. Is this extraordinary? No. We might remember that up till Vatican II, bishops did not retire. So when the synod was established, there was no awareness of what it would or could even mean ecclesiologically to have a large proportion of bishops belonging to the college who do not head a diocese. Therefore, the balance of diocesan bishops in relation to titular bishops was quite different when this institution was established. So a further reflection would be necessary. A third aspect, not a democracy, not a parliament. Time and again, one can hear in the context of synods that the church is not governed by dynamics of democracy and that it is not a parliament. The preparatory document writes, the consultation of the people of God does not imply the assumption within the church of the dynamics of democracy based on the principle of majority, because there is, at the basis of participation in every synodal process, a shared compassion for the common mission of evangelization and not the representation of conflicting interest, end of quote. Pope Francis, the day before he opened the synod, said, I want to say that the synod is not a parliament or an opinion poll. The synod is an ecclesial event, and its protagonist is the Holy Spirit. If the Spirit is not present, there will be no synod, end of quote. What can these warnings mean? Some might quickly say, in the church we don't vote. Well, the truth is that in many ecclesial bodies there is voting, also on matters of faith. In Vatican II, there was even a very advanced system of electronic voting. I think Olivetti provided for the system already. In plenary councils and episcopal conferences, there is voting not only on business matters, such as statutes or elections, but also on doctrinal questions. And yet, the purpose seems to be to obtain not just a required majority, but consensus. Vatican II says as well in Lumen Gentium, the entire body of the faithful, anointed as they are by the Holy One, cannot err in matters of belief. They manifest this special property by means of the whole people's supernatural discernment in matters of faith when, from the bishops down to the last of the lay faithful, they show universal agreement in matters of faith and morals. That discernment in matters of faith and morals is aroused and sustained by the spirit of truth, end of quote. It means that in matters of belief, the community seeks consensus, which is not the same as unanimity. Whereas unanimity, as well as a majority, originate from the world of law, consensus can be understood as referring to a discernment process under the guidance of the Holy Spirit where the truth is found. It often involves a time-consuming and painstaking process characterized by mutual listening. It implies that there is need and space for an extensive discussion about the subject concerned, in which there is ample space for a true disputatio, in which different arguments, accompanied by prayer, are brought forward and considered carefully. Consensus is a manifestation of God's participation in the discernment process. The Council of Jerusalem witnesses to this. It means that all participate, but it does not mean that all speak with the same authority. In this context, one can be reminded of the principle, quod omnes tangit ab omnibus debet approbari. So what concerns all must also be approved by all. Thus, arriving at consensus, which could be a moral consensus, is quite different from merely counting votes or determining a majority. In this regard, the 2018 Apostolic Constitution Episcopalis Communio on the Synod of Bishops is of interest because it emphasizes that in the Church there is the need for a consensus in the sense of a morally unanimous vote. It does not speak about a juridic unanimity. I quote, in the Church, the purpose of any collegial body is always the search for truth or the good of the Church. When it is therefore a question involving the faith itself, the consensus ecclesiae is not determined by tallying of votes, but is the outcome of the working of the Spirit, the soul of the one Church of Christ. The topic of majority and consensus is not only of concern to the Roman Catholic Church. In our ecumenical listening, might shed some light on the topic. The World Council of Churches has adopted the method of consensus insofar as the decisions concern topics related to faith. I had the privilege of serving on a commission of the Faith and Order commission on moral discernment in the churches, and we had to arrive at consensus. It's not a parliamentary model. The reasoning by the WCC is quite remarkable. I quote, the World Council of Churches is called to be a witness to unity in a world which is marked by tensions, antagonisms, conflicts, war, and rumors of war. In this situation, the Council can be a witness not only by its programs and resolutions, but also by the way it does its business. So it's the style, so to speak. It can shape its rules and procedures in such a way as to express faith made effective in love. This means that member churches, as well as representatives of these churches, will treat each other with respect and will seek to build one another up in love. Some churches around the world and some parts of the Council itself have found that making decisions by consensus is a better way of reflecting the nature of the Church as described in the New Testament than is the parliamentary approach. In 1 Corinthians 12, verses 12 to 27, St. Paul speaks of parts of the body needing each other. A fully functioning body integrates the gifts of all its members. Similarly, any ecumenical body will function best when it makes optimum use of the abilities, history, experience, commitment, and spiritual tradition of all the members. Consensus procedures allow more room for consultation, exploration, questioning, and prayerful reflection with less rigidity than formal voting procedures. by promoting collaboration rather than adversarial debate, consensus procedures help the assembly or a commission or a committee to seek the mind of Christ together. Rather than striving to succeed in debate, participants are encouraged to submit to one another to seek to understand what the will of the Lord is. The consensus model for decision-making also encourages prayerful listening to one another and growth in understanding between ecclesial traditions. At the same time, it requires discipline on the parts of participants and moderators. There must also be rules. But the aim is to arrive at a common mind rather than simply the will of the majority. When consensus is declared, all who have participated can confidently affirm it seemed good to the Holy Spirit and to us. I'm not saying that we should take over this model one-to-one, but I think it should give us thought for reflection on what does that mean in light of the ecclesiology that we have. I believe this aspect would need careful consideration and study, but it would be worthwhile, especially as Cardinal Mario Grech, Secretary General of the Synod of Bishops, mentioned this as one aspect to consider for the upcoming synod. If any professors of canon law are interested to, I think this would be a great subject actually for doctoral students, to take up what is consensus, what is majority, what is really behind it, where do we get these models from? Such a study should attend to another aspect that would need attention, that it might well be implied when reference is made that the church is not a parliament. I'm thinking of so-called lobby groups. This too is not foreign to the church, as it finds already mentioned in scripture. There is a need to secure that all voices can be heard, and not only those who have sufficient money to use the media and other forms of modern technology. A third aspect, the notion of representation, reflection, and giving witness. My next points will be short. Or putting it in other terms, who speaks actually on behalf of whom, with what kind of authority, on what subjects? The topic touches on the role, the function, and the tasks not only of bishops in a synod or an episcopal conference, but also of all consultative bodies in the diocese and parish. The question is, should they have a faithful or good representation of, for example, the diocese or the parish, or should they rather reflect the diocese or the parish? Interesting is, in this regard, the language used in the norms of the presbyteral and the diocesan pastoral council. Whereas the presbyteral council is to represent, representare, the priest of the presbyterate of the diocese, the diocesan pastoral council is to truly reflect the entire portion of the people of God which constitutes the diocese. But what do these terms mean? And what does it mean for the people who participate in the decision-making and taking? Do they speak for themselves and express their own faith, or do they speak on behalf of certain groups? Do bishops in an episcopal conference witness to the faith of their church, or do they express their own views in light of their personal belief? The questions are of theologically great relevance and needs careful reflection. Fifth point, participation. The need to attend to the relation between the Sacra Potestas and the Tria Munera. A major topic that indubitably will arise in the context of a more synodal church is the question of the relationship between the power of orders and jurisdiction, or, to put it in a short form, the Sacra Potestas, as well as the participation in the Tria Munera. It's a very complex topic, as it concerns, as all the canon lawyers know, Canon 129, and the related topic of laity participating in the power of governance. There are good reasons to take up these reflections, just to mention a few. In 1971, St. Paul VI allowed laymen to be appointed as judges for marriage cases. In 1974, this was expanded to other kinds of cases. With the 1983 code, women could also become judges in collegiate tribunals. The condition was that the layperson acts in a college and that the other two members be clerics. In 2010, Pope Benedict XVI clarified through a change of a canon that the deacon is not ordained in persona Christi Capitis. It means that the notion of cleric has now a different meaning. We have different kinds of clerics. In 2015, Pope Francis decided that instead of one, two lay persons beside a cleric could act in a collegiate tribunal for marriage cases. The required cleric could be a permanent deacon. In the norms on penal cases, it is now possible for lay persons to be appointed as judges. A dispensation is to be obtained, but it can be granted, and it has been granted. Earlier this year, Pope Francis decided that the Court of First Instance of Vatican City State can rule on criminal trials of bishops and cardinals. Previously, their cases were at the apostolic signatura and only heard by other cardinals and bishops. The new rules do not exclude women as judges. This development requires a deeper reflection on what it means to act in persona Christi and or to act in the name of the church. Imagine the group picture. In 1970, the three judges were three clerics, probably priests with very few deacons. And today you could have two women and a permanent deacon all with their families, and you have the court today. But we have not even begun, I think, to think about the dogmatic implications of those changes. And I think that is absolutely necessary, because once we have clarified that, we can then also see what implications that would have for other areas in the church. Judges determine about the status of a person in the church, married or not married, with very different rights and obligations. But that will come, that question will come up in this synodal church. Accountability in a synodal church is listening sufficient. The upcoming synod refers a lot to the need to listen. Could it be that there is a blind spot in that there is no mention of accountability and transparency in the church? The scandals of spiritual, financial, and sexual abuse in the church have shown the need for a reflection on the topic of accountability and transparency. Not only is the Catholic Church insufficiently governed in a synodal way, those in authority are not accountable for their decision, except bishops to the Pope and priests to the bishops, but never to the people of God. And the management of church affairs is often rather opaque. It would appear that there is a need to attend on this on the basis of a sound ecclesiology that takes its departure in baptism. It would be of interest to find out how accountability is understood and practiced in other churches and ecclesial communities, an ecumenical project that I think could be very fruitful. We have heard something about the theology. I want to conclude with a few reflections about canon law. It will be very short. The project on being a synodal church requires a conversion. It's not just structures, it requires a conversion of all. What can the contribution of canon lawyers and canon law be? Well, it all must begin with the person, the canon lawyer, him or herself. Pope Paul VI called already for a novus habitus mentis, a new attitude in mind. We need new lenses on how to see reality and how to interpret the law. How do we receive developments of and in theology that touch the interpretation of canon law? So in 1983, we got a new code of canon law. But how do the canon lawyers receive the developments in theology? How do they receive the developments in ecumenical dialogues for the interpretation of the current law? So that we would have a much more progressive interpretation and do not only an exegetical information and an historical information, but also a systematic interpretation. I think we can ask the simple question, dissertations in canon law, is chapter one a reflection about methodology? Or do we just begin with what we are doing? And how can we improve that? So in biblical, in systematic theology, you always begin with a methodological reflection. I'm not sure that has arrived yet in canon law. But development and interpretation is not new. We can learn from the past. When the 1917 code was published and issued and was still in force till 1983, what did the people do between 65 and 83? They had a new council with new council documents, but they had a law that was still effective from an earlier ecclesiology. And they were able to adapt. An important aspect that they did was they asked the question, about the mens legislatoris. Would the mens legislatoris, or the intention of the legislator, would it have a lasting impact on the interpretation of the law, or would they contribute to the mens legislatoris an historical relevance? Thus they were able, by doing the latter, they were able to receive the developments of Vatican II, to receive the developments, for example, in psychology, psychiatry. You saw this, you see this very clearly in the developments with regard to the interpretation on marriage and the capacity to enter into marriage. If you hold on to the mind of the legislator that he had, in this case now 1983, you risk stifling the community and to give old responses to new problems. Maybe some of it is also related to two excellent canon lawyers, we still have to say that, Suarez, who saw law much as a lex est ordinatio voluntatis legislatoris, so he was looking for the will of the legislator, and maybe an increased attention for Aquinas' understanding, lex est ordinatio rationis, an ordinance of reason promulgated for the good of the community by the one who has to care for the community, might help us to move in another direction. So in the interpretation, this can, but also a lot can be achieved. It allows for attributing a historical relevance to the will of the legislator and requires that the canon lawyer attends to the good of the community. The interpretation then has to be reasonable. The strength of the argument plays a decisive role. Hence, canonical terms can take on new meaning or develop in their meaning. It implies that historicity and development enter the world of canon law. Canon lawyers should be more creative. The possibility to introduce new institutions on the diocesan level and develop new ones for the entire church is certainly possible, but certainly in the dioceses. So we don't have just to sit and wait, but we can begin today. Instead of a conclusion, I would like to finish with a short story about a bishop whom I met in 2008. The bishop was a former classmate of mine, and I had given a lecture about the people of God and leadership in the church and in the local church and the people of God. And the bishop said to me, "Oh, I just moved to a new diocese, and the first thing I did was abolish the diocesan pastoral council. I don't want that, it's too time-consuming, and I don't think there's any point to it." So with a twinkle in his eye, he said to me, "So what do you think about that?" I said to him, "Do you celebrate the sacrament of confirmation?" He said, "Yes." I said, "Well, how is it?" "Oh," he said, "it's wonderful, all these young people, lively church, you know, it's really growing, it's the highlight of my life, you know, after all the difficult issues from Monday till Friday." So I said, "So what are you giving these young people?" "Oh, it's the Holy Spirit." I said, "Great. And does the Holy Spirit work in your diocese?" "Well," he said, "I don't know." I said, "How come you don't know?" "Well," he said, how would I find out?" I said, "Well, establish a diocesan pastoral council, because that's a way to discover how the Holy Spirit is working." About 10 years later, I met the bishop again. He said, "You know what, Miriam? We had that little conversation in 2008. I said, "Yes, I remember." "Well," he said, "I went home and I decided you were right. So I re-established the Diocesan Pastoral Council. It's the best thing that ever happened to me." He said, I see to it that we have a good representation of the people. We prepare important subjects together. But then he said, for example, we had a meeting recently about schools. And the question was, what shall we do with the schools? Shall we close them? Shall we move them? What shall we do? And then we looked around the table in the Diocesan Pastoral Council, and we became aware there was no parents, there was no representation of the parents, there was no students, there was no teacher, there was no principal. So we said, can we really make a decision if we don't first listen to these people? So there was agreement in the room. We transfer this subject to the next meeting, and then we will invite people to listen to them and to hear their concerns. And then he said, we discovered that if you do it that way, you take the people with you, you have listened to them, there's no problem with reception of the decision. he also said to me, we have decided in the Diocesan Pastoral Council that we prepare together the ad limina report. And we take it as an opportunity to take stock of where we are and to see where we want to go. So the ad limina report is not a burden anymore, but it's an occasion in the diocese to see what we are doing. I think this should encourage us and to go that way too. So thank you for your attention.
I think we join to thank you really very much for this presentation in which you give us food for thought. There are a lot of elements that we need to consider if we are going to start to be part of this synodal process that is the Church. I invite all of you to have some questions for Professor Vilens, questions of clarification or comments or difficult questions, maybe that's the best, because we have somebody that could help us to understand the situation today. Floor is open. Oh yes, the canon lawyer to canon lawyer, that's good.
Posso parlare in italiano?
Maybe yes.
Lei ha parlato di un punto che mi ha molto colpito, perché ero presente al... I was present at the opening of the synod, and during the speech of Father or Cardinal Gresh, the thing I was very surprised is about the consensus and voting. I said, "Ooh, perché sono un canonista forse?" Perché lui ha detto non bisogno perché ha presentato la cosa. Come sì, la votazione nel sinodo dei vescovi, come si faceva punto dopo punto. Questi testi molto importanti, uno vota dopo l'altro e prende un tempo immenso, per qualche volta poco interesse, perché tutti sono d'accordo. E dunque ha detto bisogna passare a un modo dove votiamo soltanto i punti importanti. But chi decide quali sono i punti importanti? E come si vede, lei l'ha detto bene, come si vede quando c'è non la necessità di andare al voto perché c'è il consenso? Non so se.
Thank you. Grazie. Somebody else?
Well, maybe we should briefly also for the people who are do not understand the Italian. So maybe if I repeat your question, then we can also see if I understood your question. So you are saying you were present in the preliminary, the opening of the synod that Saturday morning, where Cardinal Gregg suddenly came with this surprise for all of us. Yes. For me, it was a surprise. The consensus that maybe we should arrive, and not just majority, but arrive at consensus. And you were saying that he said maybe there would only be a need to attend to the important points, whereas in the past, you would, article by article, you would vote on. And your question is, who decides what are the important points? And and who decides that there is no need to vote? Yeah. I don't know. I mean, I am not, a Cardinal Gregg, I think, has not the answer. I don't think he has the answer. I think he is asking you, as Dean of the Faculty of Canon Law, he was a student here, yes, but now he is bringing his back because everybody is to be involved in the process and we all have to contribute. So I think what I mentioned from the World Council of Churches, it is really fascinating that in the World Council of Churches, we do not vote. Now, I don't know, in ARCHIC or other dialogues, do you vote?
No.
No. In Arctic we do. Okay.
Vote of consensus.
So the interesting is, so I can maybe explain how this works in the WCC. You have a document, and then we work with cards, orange and blue. And the orange card means I warm up to this idea. It also goes for the whole meeting, and it goes very quick because you can see if there are a lot of orange cards, you can see there is no need to have five more people say the same thing because you can see there is consensus in the room. Let's move to the next subject. The moment there is a blue card, the moderator has to say, what is exactly, you obviously have a problem somewhere. What's your problem? And then you begin a conversation about what is the problem and how can we accommodate for this problem? How can we find a solution? So if there is no blue card anymore in the room, that means we have moved to a consensus. Now, I remember we had a document on the moral discernment and one person kept this blue card. So the question is then, what shall we do? And ultimately, the moderator asked the question, you have brought forward your ideas. Do you feel that you had sufficient time and opportunity to express your views? He said, yes. Do you feel that we have seriously discussed and considered your point? Yes. Well, then he said, I want to have it in a footnote to the document. Somebody said, no, we can't, because the footnote would include a consensus of the whole group. So we can't include the footnote. And then the proposal was made that in the minutes of the meeting, and they will be published, the minutes of the meeting, there will be a remark what exactly the objection, or the, maybe not even objection, but the reservation of this person was. But that the person felt, and I just read the minutes yesterday, that the person felt that they are, that he was hurt. Hurt, not hurt, like, I'm sorry, but audire. So I think we have to see what that really means for consensus. We also have to remember Vatican II, the documents have like a 95% quorum. Of course, you get then into compromises. So the clarity of the text, sometimes there is on the one side, on the other side. But it also asks people, I think, who are very skilled in expressing compromises. But I think we should reflect on it. Yes.
Thank you very much. It was very interesting. I'm not completely sure what I want to say, so I'm going to be thinking about it as I'm speaking. But I'm also thinking about another lecture we had here a week or so ago. Well, we had a Dies Academicus here, and the second lecture, the
so
Italian.
We also have Albertus
okay,
Magnus.
Great.
Yes.
So we had an Italian theologian, Monsignor Sequeri, and he really impressed me because of his use of language coming out of subjects like cultural anthropology, sociology of culture, social psychology. I mean, I am in social sciences, so I could recognize this language, and I could hear this theologian making use of these ways of thinking in a very useful way, in a really intelligent way. And so my feeling is that one of the things that holds us up in dealing with this discussion is that this push which Pope Francis is really asking for, which is a much more greater interdisciplinary capacity, and we pontifical universities, we should be developing this more. We're just at the beginning of developing it, you know. And if you think about, let's say, about the priests and people in the hierarchy, I mean, they study philosophy and theology. You know, until about the 1700s, philosophy was a pretty good subject in order to understand what's going on in the world. But philosophy's now spawned all these other subjects, you know, as a result of the Industrial Revolution and the French Revolution. And a lot of the things that you're talking about are really deeply studied in these subjects, you know. But we don't have enough connection between them and what's going on in the process like this. So I suppose it's a kind of a plea. I felt Monsignor Sequeri's talk last week was a sort of a wake-up call to our university. And now you're saying something which to me also seems to be pushing us more in this direction. Of course, the difficulty is how to do it in a really intelligent way. We don't want to lose the real power of the specializations that people have, but we do also need to develop a way of bringing the disciplines together to resolve problems like, you know, how do we understand representation in this process? I mean, as you know, there's so much written about this. If we could only find a way to bring the relevant elements of it into this process, it would be a real benefit to all of us. And I think it is there in the idea that people who study theology study philosophy first. You know, as you said, until the last 300 years, that was a pretty good preparation for that. But it's not enough now, if you see what I mean, to deal with these kinds of things. Okay, that's my
thing. No, I fully agree with you. I mean, I teach at the University of Erfurt, which is a completely secularized society. We live in an environment of 3% Catholics, and a total population is about 25% baptized, and the rest is just nothing. Nobody, it's not another religion, it's just nothing. And this has been going on for generations, you know. These generations are short there, because usually people get their children when they are 20, 21, so you have five generations in one century. But it means, like, ever since Nazi Germany, there has been no... So, we have to be careful that we don't live in a bubble over there. And we were just talking on Arbetus Magnus, which is our patron saint as well. We had a meeting with the bishop saying it is interesting for our seminarians because the seminary has been opened now to other students of other disciplines. It has been changed because it means that the students, they talk with people who study architecture or totally different things, and they have to interact. Now, the people who live there are still Catholics. So the students who do live in that seminary, but they are Catholics who study architecture or so. But that already asks for a different vocabulary to be used and to explain what we are doing. Now, this is just on the level of students, but of course, as professors, so in my university, I have to communicate. We have what we call a studium fundamentale, in which every professor by contract is obliged to teach every term one course with a colleague from another faculty. So you always have to find somebody who is willing to. For the others, it's not so difficult to find a partner. But for us, to somebody who is willing to dance with us, the theologians, because we are extraordinary. Oh my God, the theologians. So I've been for years giving a course called The Well-Being of Children, which is related to my abuse. And it's the most wanted course in the university, but I've learned so much in dealing with medical doctors and with philosophers. You know, the dignity of the person, what does that mean? Ask a philosopher. Ethical decisions in all of this. So I think we have to, how beautiful these entities are that we have as universities, among ourselves, in our ecclesial little world. But do they make us fit to go on the Piazza Venezia and explain to the people what we are doing here? And if we, at the end of the day, are not able to translate, first of all, to hear what they are saying and what their concerns are, but then also to answer to their questions, then I don't know if we are sufficiently attending to our task. But that's a major challenge, I mean. And maybe I began with these two Dominicans, Gauthier and Tillard. I mean, Gauthier would have said to us, but in the beginning, a history, Roman law, these two things that he did, you know, look to what society, in the context in which they lived, they adapted from society and felt what is possible. So we can't just say, and we have this with Gaudium et Spes, the world, the churches in the world, so we have to engage in that conversation.
Thank you very much for your presentation, Professor Ressa. sorry. You try to make the very clear distinction between synodality and democracy. Yet, I think that's probably where there seems to be a challenge. A challenge in the sense that we are already used to democracy. And maybe if we look in some of the continents, in some of the local churches, we see that the bishops are trying to speak, and other groups are also standing up to speak. And they think that maybe they are speaking the voice of the church, and maybe the bishops are speaking the voice of the world. How do we really deal with this so that it doesn't bring down a division in the church?
I'm not sure I understand your question, but maybe it has to do with acoustics.
Yes, so my question is trying to say, so how do we really handle synodality so that it doesn't lead to divisions in the church, when everybody may want to speak and think that maybe they are not listening to, you made the point again, who do we listen to?
Yes.
And when people feel that they are not listened to and they think that they're supposed to be listened to, and so that is where I don't know whether I'm making my point clear. It's a question, how do we handle synodality? Because my point is, I'm thinking synodality may be looked upon like democracy.
Yes.
So how do we handle it so that it doesn't...
Well, I think the fundamental point is the question, what does it mean to be baptized? And how do we feel that the Holy Spirit works in every single person? Democracy is not only about an equality of people, but democracy is also, and this is another challenge that I did not mention, but that the church also in light of the abuse scandal has to look into, is the different powers that we have. With the French Revolution, we got Montesquieu and his three divisions. So how does that unfold for the church? And I think these are issues that we will have to attend to too. And then we come to that issue of accountability. So these are serious questions that are being sent to us from, if you like, from the context in which we live. But at the same time, the scandals that we have at the moment show a little bit of, or should make us reflect for a moment, what are we actually doing and how are we making decisions? So I've been involved in many of these abuse cases as the investigating person. I was delegated by the bishop to do that. And many bishops tend to immediately stand or reflect on the side of themselves and the priest. They forget that the victim is also a person entrusted to their care. But the victim is seen as outside. It's not one of we. So the question that the bishop then has to ask is, who are the we? So these double roles that they would have, and how can they combine all of that at the same time? Is that possible? Is that responsible? Is that not only from a practical level, but also what does that mean theologically? So how can we reflect on that?
Thank you very much for your presentation. I have three short questions. The first one, what do we do as church when there is no consensus? What to do, or it's the end of synodality, or we have to wait, but some questions are not only important, they are urgent. You talked about the crisis and abuse. So what to do when we don't reach the consent? Second question, talked about the importance of the Holy Spirit. Of course, I totally agree, but I ask myself also, is there a danger, or in other words, is there a criteriology of the Holy Spirit? Who decides if the Holy Spirit were present or not? And that could be a danger, Is there a kind of consensus, but the bishop or the pope say, no, but I didn't see the Holy Spirit. How can we recognize him? And the third question, you talked about participation on decision making. What chance do you see in the Codex? For example, you talked about the sensus fidei is missing in the Codex. What chance do you see on decision making, even for the people of God?
Well, thank you. First of all, when there is no consensus, I'm a layperson, but I would ask the people who are members of religious institutes, when they go to a chapter and there is no agreement. I remember sometimes people call me from the chapter, in the middle of the chapter, we have so many people who don't vote, they abstain from voting. What does that mean? Is the majority, what kind of majority do we need? And then I say, wait a minute, if people don't vote, that means they are not ready. So you will have to take another round in order to come to the discernment process, to complete that discernment process. So if there is no consensus, it means you can't make a decision. And a forced decision, and then it depends on the subject, would then be dangerous, because then the question can be, was this a wise decision to make? At sometimes on the practical level, you might say, we will make a decision for the time being, but we will have, because you have to move on something. But on doctrine, you don't do that. You don't usually move because we have to do something. On the practical level, that might be necessary. But then you say, but we will, this is not the final decision. This is a solution for the time being, and we will have to continue this conversation. I think in the synodal process, we can learn so much from the religious institutes. And actually, I'm leading an international research project on accountability, and one of our participants is your master, former Master General Timothy Radcliffe. And I think it is very interesting. So with Pope Francis, we have the Jesuits. It's a different style of decision making, whereas the Dominicans is a much more horizontal style. As a canon lawyer, I don't know if you are a canon lawyer, but I always say this translates, for example, in the Dominican style would always require that the counselors is an equal number, so that with the superior together, there's an unequal number. Whereas in the Jesuit tradition, you would have a counselors who have an unequal number because the council advises the superior, which means you can't end up in a path all the time. So it needs to be unequal, three or five people who then can recommend or... So it's a whole different culture that is behind this. But if there is no consensus, you have to wait. And I think... that also relates then to the Holy Spirit. Now, I'm not a professor in pneumatology, and I think we need to bring this more to the fore and to develop that and to enter into that conversation with people who can do that. How do we determine that? But what I would say is that there is a certain tranquility in the community. There is a certain kind of peace in the whole group when you feel there is a consensus and that the Spirit is working. And then indeed you see at the Council of Jerusalem, at the end they could say it was good to the Holy Spirit and to us. I know that doesn't really answer your question, but take that course on pneumatology and ask the questions there and come and tell us what you discovered. Participation in decision making, well, that's why I was saying I think we need to reconsider what baptism really means. So we speak about lay people involved in as judges, for example. Now, that's a tremendous thing, but it's not many people do think about that. What would that really mean if we have that, and what consequences could flow from that? The canon lawyers here would be able to give you 14 weeks of lectures on Sacra Potestas and Tria Munera, and we still would not have an answer. This is a tremendously debated question among canon lawyers, which culminates in Canon 129 of the Code of Canon Law. There are different schools of thought on this subject. whether the sacra put, and one of them is historical and the other one is more systematic. The historical group is more the Roman school, who would say in the past the lay people have exercised jurisdiction without being ordained. Whereas in particular the Munich school with the Sacra Potestas would say, no, you cannot anymore after Vatican II, where power of order and jurisdiction was brought together in the Sacra Potestas, lay people cannot participate in that anymore. Everybody, if I ask my students, they always, if I say these are the two theories, which do you think is the Roman one, which is the Munich one, they always have it the wrong way around. Because everybody thinks that the Romans would say lay people cannot participate, whereas the Munich school would, but it's just the other way around. So I think we need to reflect on that, whether that really holds. And I personally think history is an important aspect in that. So I live in Erfurt, and the Munich school doesn't exist anymore. So the people who teach today in Munich don't hold this position. This also should be known, but it's a position from the past. But we need to attend to that. But I think we need to ask the question anew, because the question is not can people who are not ordained participate? I think the question should be, what does it mean to be baptized and to participate in the threefold ministry of Christ? And what does it mean for a bishop to delegate power and a person to participate in the delegated power? What does that really mean? And it was from that I said in my lecture, I think we need to differentiate between acting in persona Christi and acting in the name of the church. And if we would have some clarification on some of these terms, that might help as well. So major research projects to be done there. The synod in 2023 is only the inaugural lecture or something when it closes. It's the beginning of a process. It's not like the Second Vatican Council. It was the beginning of a process, not the closing in 1965.
I think, Professor Weilens, you put us in the clear way about what are the canonical and theological challenges that a synodal process is putting to us. But we also hear you saying that the synodal process is a process in which we need to see the infallibility in credendo of everyone in the church. So we are looking very much to see that, but in the meantime, we would like to thank you very much to give us a lot of input to talk and a lot of interesting inputs also to reflect about our participation in the synod, in the process of the synod. Now in course in our church. Thank you very much indeed. I just remind you that in 17 December we will have the next and the last of this year TR share, and it will be Markus Plested.
Markus Plested is an Orthodox theologian, an English theologian teaching at Marquette University in the States. He is also a specialist of the reception of Thomas Aquinas, but he will speak also on synodality this time. So see you next month. Thank you for being with us tonight.